some additional information before we bring our guest speaker up, Dr. Scholz. I was just asked this question just 30 seconds ago. Where's the restroom? So, out the door to the right, both men's and ladies' restroom are out the door to the right. I know that prostate cancer people really need to be aware of where that is. So, if you have to, that's where it is, although most people don't generally leave it when leave the room when Dr. Scholz is here. We do have to support our operation here. So I'm going to have two of my board members pass a basket, and you don't have to contribute, obviously, but if you can, it would help us out supporting the doc and the church and the people that come here and our expenses. We get about half our expenses from your generous donations and the rest of it from the community. So, Webb, do you have there's Bert. Where's Bert? He generally helps us. And find somebody else to help you out. We are a very active organization, as you know, but being an active organization, we need active people. So if there's anybody that would like to volunteer to help us do the things that we do with these meetings or anything else that we do, there's two advantages to that. First of all, you help us bring in the super docs that we get here because we do supply an abundance of people for them to speak to, which is very necessary. And also, you learn how to take care of yourself. There's nothing more educational than coming to a support group and getting involved with a support group and learning everything that the support group members do, and you will learn yourself. So see me or any of the board members, Webb there, for instance, and Charles sitting here. If you're interested in helping us out and get involved, you will create an atmosphere that helps your own survival. Boy, it's quiet here. Okay, at least I know I have your attention. As we all know, well, before I get into that, there's a table out there, the first table that you come to, has a plethora of forms and things like that, I can't even fan them out like I'd like to, that are out there that Dr. Scholz has graciously allowed me to copy. If you go to his office, he has these all in his walls up there. But he puts out more information. He must have to have three patients' fees just to put out all the information that he puts out up there. And he allows us to copy it, and we copy it and provide it for you, and then we also copy it for the convention that's every September. We have the convention up there. Not only are these ones that I copied, but there's also how to pick the best treatment for prostate cancer, diet, vitamins, exercise for prostate cancer. All this literature is out there, and it's a wealth of good information. You should read everything out there. I know you're not going to do that, but you should. As we all know, prostate cancer is the second leading cause of cancer deaths in men in the United States today. There are less than, well, it says 50 on my gouge here, but in Dr. Scholz's literature it says 30, so I'll take his number. He's more familiar with it than I am. There are less than 30 prostate cancer oncologist specialists in the USA, even though it's the second leading cause of prostate cancer, cancer deaths. And we have the undisputed best of the best right here in our backyard in Marina Del Rey, with Dr. Mark Scholz. Dr. Scholz was born and raised in Southern California, so he's a native. Went to college at local universities and finished his medical schooling at USC. He's been the principal investigator in clinical trials involving astaxanthin, two trials with ipilimumab, two trials with abiraterone, oral MDV 3100, modified citrus pectin, taxotere versus mitoxantrone, and Provenge. Those are just the clinical trials that he's been involved with. He's also been interviewed on several TV talk shows. Dr. Scholz is the medical director of the Prostate Oncologist Specialist, a group practice in Marina Del Rey, with Dr. Richard Lamb and Dr. Jeffrey Turner. He is also co-founder of the Prostate Cancer Research Institute, better known as PCRI, and hosts the annual National Prostate Cancer Conference every September. Just a couple of weeks ago, he had the midterm conference, which was an extreme success. The conference in September is the undisputed best prostate cancer conference in the nation, with the best of the best doctors attending and making presentations. Dr. Scholz is the co-author of the newly published book entitled Invasion of the Prostate Snatchers. No more unnecessary biopsies, radical treatment, or loss of sexual potency. He continues as a primary investigator to actively supervising a number of ongoing prostate cancer clinical trials and has authored or co-authored over 90 scholarly articles and abstracts in his area of expertise. I'm the CEO of the Prostate Forum of Orange County, and Dr. Scholz is my doctor. Dr. Scholz.
Thanks, Boo. What a warm. Thank you so much. Am I loud enough in the back, everybody? Great. Thanks again for having me here. This is a pleasure. I talk about the kind of stuff we're going to talk about tonight all day long. And so I get a lot of practice talking about this. I'm going to try and streamline it for you because usually people like to ask questions at the end. So I'm hoping to run through these slides in maybe about 30, 40 minutes. Before I do that, you all should have received a packet. If you did, there's some good info in here. There's a couple articles on this topic of hormone therapy and also side effects, which is what I'm going to cover in fair detail tonight. And there's a few things about our practice. There's also a listing of approved MRI centers this is an area that's moving quickly where people are starting to look to use MRIs rather than biopsies to try and find out where the prostate cancer is inside the gland. We have a practice brochure and that's a few other good things. So that's all for you to take home and look at. So the talk tonight, hormone therapy is a great topic to cover. They're really, if I think of all the other cancers, and you know there are over 100 types of cancer, there doesn't really exist anti-cancer treatment anywhere near as effective as hormone therapy. So if you talk about lung cancer, colon cancer, those people have to take chemotherapy to try and control the disease. Hormone therapy just beats those treatments in terms of long-term remissions, complete remissions, improved survival, and some of that I'll share with you tonight. So it's really a spectacular treatment. The confusion always comes in prostate cancer, of course, is weighing the side effects of the hormone therapy or any treatment, chemo, against the potential advantages. And we're always playing this balancing act. And usually, in the earlier years when I'd give talks about any type of a treatment, I'd usually emphasize all the good things it does first, and then we have a few quick slides at the end to show the bad side effects, because everyone wants to live, and we're willing to pay a price in terms of side effects if we can live longer. I mean, it's a fair trade. But with prostate cancer, as you know, sometimes the disease, even without treatment, doesn't require that much treatment. So that creates confusion because there are indeed side effects, and therefore you have to look at how big an advantage you're going to get. And specifically, when you talk about the different types of prostate cancer, you know, the more serious life-threatening ones, obviously you're willing to put up with more side effects. But what about these milder ones? And of course, it gets really confusing when you get in the transition, in the gray zone, the sort of worrisome cancers. Should we give hormone therapy to those people or not? So I'm going to try and help you understand that there's no quick answer, But if you, and to reach a conclusion, every individual is going to have to look at the side effects, which I'm going to start talking about first. And then, with the knowledge of what this hormone therapy can do in terms of its side effects, and we'll follow up in terms of what can it do in terms of making people live longer. And then, with that information, you can balance out whether or not hormone therapy is going to be appropriate. So, with that, I think we'll jump right in. This whole topic of, let me see if I got everything right. So that works, that, and that goes there. So the whole topic of side effects, of course, is a huge one in the realm of prostate cancer. But we usually think of the side effects from surgery and radiation, because those are the upfront initial treatments that are often used. And what's notable is the fact that often they're irreversible. Many of the side effects we talk about tonight with hormone therapy will be reversible. Irreversible side effects from surgery or radiation, the three common things you think of are loss of ability to get erections, urinary leakage or irritation, and rectal damage, because everything anatomically is located tightly around the prostate. So this idea of irreversible side effects, or any kind of side effects, obviously is a huge theme with prostate cancer to begin with. But when you start talking about hormone therapy, the, I went backwards, I'm sorry. There we go. We're really talking about the fact that prostate cancer cells need testosterone just like anything living needs air. The thing comes up, and we'll take a slide and address it later, does testosterone cause prostate cancer? And I would say, just like we don't think of air or oxygen causing life, we need it to live, but it doesn't cause it. And it works that way with prostate cancer and even the prostate gland, the cancer comes from. The gland will shrink if there's no testosterone. It needs testosterone to live. So this is a picture of the actual molecule. This is manufactured in the testicles, released into the bloodstream when men go through puberty. The prostate starts to enlarge and grow, and then as we get older, probably for reasons of inflammation in the gland throughout the years, cancers start to develop. But if you take the testosterone away, the prostate gland and the cancer will shrivel up. Some people mistakenly believe that when you give testosterone blockade, that you're just putting the cancer to sleep. And you're actually killing probably 99%+ of the cancer cells. The problem is that usually there's that 1% that's left behind that can potentially grow back later. So it's while it doesn't radically cut cancers, tumors down, it often will not be able to eliminate them completely. So we're going to jump right into this. Well, when you have low testosterone, whether it be from treatment or from age or whatever, you get the same type of effects. And of course, the more severe suppression of the testosterone, the more severe the side effects. The common things we think of are loss of sex drive, slowing down metabolism, which results in weight gain, changes in mood, depression, and hot flashes. And I'll come back and talk just a little bit more detail about these things and what we sometimes do about them. Inability to get erections. This is usually a reversible problem, because if testosterone is restored, this problem can recover. Loss of nighttime erections can cause permanent shrinkage. Low blood counts, and tiredness. These are quite a daunting list of scary side effects we're talking about, and of course, there are things that can be done about that, and part of my talk is to inform you about that. But there is certainly, when you list all these things that I've just mentioned to you, you say this can be a pretty, show me the good part, okay? I mean, this is a pretty intimidating list of things that can happen. So I'm going to go through and talk about some of the ways to minimize, not necessarily eliminate these side effects, but minimize the side effects from having a low testosterone. One of the most dramatic things is, you know, here's a young guy that hasn't gone through his puberty, hasn't got his muscles yet, and this is, we can literally regress to this kind of a state when we have low testosterone. Men lose their muscles very quickly. It's not just a cosmetic thing. It's a sense of weakness and tiredness that can ensue. Now, it turns out that in us guys, if we will be faithful and lift weights and exercise, that we can maintain our muscles many times. It's a hard thing to ask someone to do when you don't have testosterone, but it works really well. Other things that you try and think of, well, what about if you're giving testosterone inactivating pharmaceuticals, hormone therapy, the TIP is my little acronym for that, giving it for a shorter period of time. I'm going to show you some slides a little later about who needs long-term, who needs short-term treatment. There are milder hormone blocking medicines like Casodex. We typically think of LHRH agonists like Lupron as the main hormone therapy, but in some cases you can use a milder pill and substitute and have less side effects. And then after the treatment is done, usually hormone therapy isn't given indefinitely, it's given for some time period, 4 months, 12 months, 18 months, but it's quite variable how quickly people recover when the treatment is stopped. In fact, some men, as they get to their 70s and 80s, they can take 12 months of testosterone blockade, stop the treatment, and never, for the rest of their life, recover testosterone. And that's not intended. We don't stop, as a physician, we don't stop hormone treatment without expecting testosterone to return. Therefore, shouldn't we be able to administer some testosterone to help those guys get back to normal once they stop? So the fatigue factor, primarily we rely on weight training, 3 times a week in the gym, 3 sets, 10 reps, build muscles, upper body, lower body, core strength, and a number of studies have shown it has a dramatic benefit in reducing the side effects and the tiredness. Now, I showed this slide at our mid-year thing as a little bit of a joke in terms of, you know, the loss of libido that occurs when men have no testosterone. Literally, there is no distinction between these two images in terms of which creates more sexual interest. When men have a low testosterone. And there's some laughter in the audience because men, when you warn men in advance that this is going to happen, they don't respond. And you can see behind their eyes they're saying, Dr. Scholz doesn't know about my libido. And then they come in wide-eyed, and 6-8 weeks later, and say, I never would have thought it's possible, but I truly have zero interest. And this occurs in about 90% of men that go on your standard hormone treatments. It reverses, usually reverses completely, but when the treatment is stopped. But in some men, older men, that the resumption of libido may be, this is just some guy that lost his libido, unfortunately, apparently on his honeymoon. And so it's a hard thing to measure. When people have been diagnosed with a cancer, you think the last thing they're going to worry about is their libido. They're thinking about survival. There's a lot of fear in the air. And this is not prioritized very much, but as people start to realize, in many cases, some types of prostate cancer aren't as dangerous as we thought, and they start thinking about it, and it's a real big change in lifestyle, and it's a real problem. The other problem that we see, and there are really 3 major ones. Libido is a huge one. The other one is that when metabolism slows down, there's a almost invariable weight gain unless people take special precautions. And it is, I've seen people gain 10 to 50 pounds after starting hormone blockade. And it is a troublesome thing because they didn't change their diet. They didn't start eating more. They just kept eating the same diet they were eating prior to having testosterone. But they've lost their muscle mass, their metabolic rate has dropped down, and now they're just steadily adding more and more body weight. So there's this is not just a cosmetic thing. This is actually called the metabolic syndrome. And there are concerns that this is the explanation for why there is, in some studies, not all studies, an indication that there may be a higher risk of heart attacks with hormone therapy. And it doesn't surprise me. I mean, if you take someone that's maybe already a little bit overweight and then add 50 pounds on top of that, aren't we going to see some more heart attacks? The answer is we're definitely going to see some more heart attacks. So I don't believe that the hormone therapy itself causes heart attacks, and I've got strong reasons to believe that, but I certainly believe that radical weight gain can cause heart attacks. And so this is a real concern with with hormone therapy. Mood swings and depression. Testosterone sort of fortifies us guys against mood swings. You think of as general, the male sex maybe a little more level-headed than the fairer sex. This issue is a very real one. Men will come to me and say, for the first time, I'm crying in movies after, some men like the feeling of a much richer and deeper sense of emotional reaction. Other men are kind of scared or intimidated by it. There are things, and I've got a list of pills at the end that we can talk about to try and help with this problem. And this is my favorite one. The men do get hot flashes. This is an issue with hormone therapy. In my experience, you divide men into thirds. About a third of men on hormone therapy don't get hot flashes. About a third of men will get something they think it might be a hot flash, something subtle. And about a third of men get something really radical that can wake them up at night, disturb their sleep. And there are treatments for this. They're not dangerous. They can be very disconcerting and sort of destabilizing, and people wonder if there's something bad happening because they truly have a sense of not feeling well, but there's never been any danger or direct health risk associated with them. So there are ways to soften the blow of all these things. And I just list a bunch of medicines. You'll notice I didn't talk about the exercise. When you talk about exercise and diet, everyone says, yeah. But if you just have to take a pill, well, I'll consider doing that. So there are medicines. These medicines are FDA approved to help people with narcolepsy. That's, excess sleepiness. And they have some benefit, just like perhaps some caffeine can have some benefit for the fatigue that can be associated with hormone therapy. I didn't talk too much about osteoporosis, but it's a real issue. Just like a woman going through menopause can lose 10% of her calcium from her bones in the first year or two of menopause, men can lose 10% of their calcium from their bones in the first year of taking hormone treatment. And that is easily preventable with a variety of medicines. And so, I don't know, it seems like the standard practice in the medical community is to check bone densities and see if people become osteoporotic and then start treatment. It doesn't make any sense to me. Why not just take a simple pill once a month and prevent osteoporosis? So whenever I have patients that go on hormone treatment, I just put them on some kind of medicine to prevent the development of osteoporosis. We're all hoping to live, as we get older and older, we know we're gonna lose bone. The last thing we need to do is spend 10 to 15% of our bones in a 12-month period. We routinely put patients on medications so men can get erections, whether they're sexually active or not, to keep the apparatus functional. We don't put everybody on a pill to prevent breast enlargement. It only happens in about 20 to 25% of men. But if it happens, it doesn't go away when you stop. The breasts are permanent. So what we counsel people is to watch very closely if they develop any tenderness, to start a medication called Femara immediately, and that prevents the breast enlargement. For mood swings, tiny doses of antidepressants seem to, when men come in and say that these mood swings are driving me nuts, tiny doses, like just 10 milligrams of Zoloft, and they say, I feel normal again. And it really helps a lot. Not full doses, just small doses of these antidepressant medicines. Low red counts, not commonly a problem, but sometimes can be a contributor to feeling tired, what we call anemia, and there are medicines to reverse that. This medicine is not a magic pill, but it does help keep weight down. And it does also, metformin, which is FDA approved for the treatment of adult onset diabetes, also has a modest anti-cancer effect. It's been on the market for about 30 years. It's a generic, very cheap, and so it's quite common for us to administer this medicine to men that are on hormone therapy. And last of all, we talked about low sex drive. There is a medicine called Wellbutrin that in certain fairly rare cases will restore libido. No one knows exactly why. I wish it occurred more commonly, but it can work for that purpose. So I talked to you, at first I said testosterone is kind of like air for prostate. It doesn't cause prostate cancer. There have been a number of studies that have looked at testosterone. Does it actually cause prostate cancer? The answer is no. It doesn't. It is necessary for prostate cancer to exist, but it doesn't actually cause it. A question also comes up, and since we're talking about hormone therapy could mean taking testosterone. Now, up to this point, I've been talking about removing testosterone as a treatment for prostate cancer. What about taking testosterone to restore men back to normal, for perhaps after they have previous treatment? Is that crazy? It sounds crazy. For many years, people thought you would never want to do that. You might stimulate the cancer to grow. But the same logic, if people can go through a treatment period of, say, a year and stop, if they're not going to recover their normal testosterone, why can't we give them the same amount of testosterone they would have recovered normally? It's just like anyone else in the general population. So this has been looked at more and more carefully, and it is becoming more widely accepted now that yes, you can give testosterone to someone that has had previous prostate cancer in a certain context. And so situations, men that would otherwise be safe for active surveillance. You know, there are types of prostate cancer, little grade 6 specks of cancer we know will never spread. If they're running low testosterone levels, why can't they have a normal testosterone just like all the other men in the country who are on active surveillance? They all have normal testosterone. We're not taking their testosterone away. So if someone had a favorable cancer, wanted to do active surveillance, but was running a low testosterone, yes, that person could take testosterone to have it restored to normal levels. Men, some men on intermittent hormone therapy to suppress prostate cancer. Certain guys can take holidays. I'm not going to talk too much about intermittent therapy tonight. We can take questions about it. But if they don't recover their normal testosterone, why can't they take some testosterone so that their testosterone comes back to normal? And then what about people that have had, as we said before, they're treated for a period of time, we believe they're cured, they've paid their debt. In other words, the studies show that there's no additional advantage for having low testosterone beyond a year or two. This has been looked at, and I'll show you some studies to document that. But where would it be a bad idea to take testosterone? Well, in people that are, say, taking Lupron or taking testosterone and activating pharmaceuticals, and their PSA is going up and up, in other words, they're developing hormone resistance, that's not the type of place where you want to be adding testosterone. Obviously, you want to find a way to get rid of any residual testosterone. If people are just recently diagnosed and they're trying to be cured by taking a testosterone-blocking agent, you don't want to give them testosterone. And this sort of situation, it comes up quite a bit. So we have people that will go through hormone treatments, presumably get cured, and their testosterone is recovering relatively slowly, and we talk to them about taking some testosterone to bring things back to normal. But then you find out that their spouse has absolutely zero libido. And you say, why would I want to restore my libido, Dr. Scholz? I'm just going to get frustrated. My spouse has zero interest in any kind of sexual activity. So this is something we talked about briefly at the mid-year conference. Couples want to either both have a good libido or both have a bad libido, but you don't want to have one with a good libido and one with a bad libido, right? I mean, that doesn't make any sense. So the idea of matching libidos between partners is a logical idea. And so restoring testosterone is not for everybody. Okay, when you talk about giving testosterone, I've sort of digressed here briefly. We're talking about giving testosterone in certain situations. We're going to go back to talking about hormone therapy for prostate cancer very quickly here. But it turns out that giving testosterone, the main concern everyone has been thinking about is the possibility of it stimulating prostate cancer. But it turns out that giving testosterone might have other risks besides stimulating prostate cancer. One of them is a concern about heart disease. There's been studies done, in fact, one study published in the New England Journal of Medicine, it had to be stopped early because they randomized two groups of men with low testosterone. They didn't have prostate cancer. They had low testosterone, half of them got their testosterone levels restored, the other half they just watched, and they showed a higher incidence of heart attacks and strokes in the men that took the testosterone. And they stopped the study early because the incidence was scary enough. They said, this looks like it's dangerous. We shouldn't be doing this. So what's going on? I mean, men normally have testosterone. Do they have more strokes and heart attacks than people that don't have testosterone? Anyone answer that question? Do people with testosterone, men, have more heart attacks and strokes than people without testosterone, women? Of course they do, right? Men usually die around 75, and women live to be an average of 80. They live 5 years longer, right? Why is that? Low testosterone actually, high testosterone actually causes the blood to get thicker. This is why men can run marathons faster than women. They have more oxygen carrying capacity. But they're also pumping thicker blood for an extra 40, ever since puberty, they've been pumping thicker blood, they wear their hearts out and have more strokes younger than women do. So that is thought to be the primary reason. And so when men go on testosterone, they need to have their blood counts checked. Some men start getting really thick red blood counts. You've heard of blood doping, remember, the guy that, Lance Armstrong, that used to give himself shots to thick. There's a risk when you do that of causing a heart attack because your blood gets so thick and sludgy it puts a great strain on the heart. So testosterone, whenever we give testosterone, and we give testosterone, we only have prostate cancer patients, and some of our patients are receiving testosterone, we always monitor the red count very closely. And if it gets too high, we tell them that they need to go donate blood and get that count down so they don't have a heart attack or a stroke. So it's not a completely risk-free thing. Some people, since estrogen is synthesized from testosterone in the body, so estrogen levels go up when you administer testosterone. And there is some evidence that estrogen has a procoagulant or an increased risk of causing clots. And so that's the other theory as to why there is a higher risk of heart attacks and strokes in people who take testosterone. So nothing's risk-free. So all these risks have to be balanced out. It's not a total slam dunk that if you don't worry about prostate cancer, you got nothing to worry about. There are issues with taking testosterone. But of course, you saw all those side effects of having low testosterone, right? Quality of life is also an incredibly important thing. So all these things have to be balanced out and managed in an expert way. The way that you give testosterone, there's a lot of different ways. There's patches, creams, shots. These pellets are put underneath, they're little wax matrix pellets, they're stuck under the skin, and they keep the testosterone levels normal for about 4 months. So there's a lot of different ways to do this sort of thing. I've got one slide for women. We talked about having unbalanced libidos. I think I showed this slide also at the mid-year update conference. It's not often considered that postmenopausal women, when they lose their hormone production, they lose small amounts of testosterone also. And many of them completely lose all interest in sexual activity. Sexual activity and libido comes mostly from testosterone, a little bit from estrogen. So it's the testosterone that is lost that causes low libido in postmenopausal women. The small amounts of testosterone can be administered and restore a normal libido in a postmenopausal woman. So again, this idea of balancing libidos can occur on both sides of the equation. There's some other advantages too, because I put these in here for when the guys are trying to sell their wives on this. The people that have a low libido don't really care about it. It's like, doesn't matter, does it? And but their partner who has a high libido, it does matter. And so it's hard to explain why you want to have a libido. It doesn't really compute. So, but you might want to have better mood. You might want to have higher energy. You might want to be able to lose body fat easier. Oh, okay. Man, all right, sign me up. I think I'll take it. So, so there are advantages for this, and there are doctors. We have a list. I didn't have enough space in the slide to put it, but we can. How can we, if people are interested in finding those brief references?
You can ask me, and I can email it to you.
Yeah. So there's a list of doctors that specialize in what's called bioidentical hormones that we can provide that for you. Okay, so we're going to go back now to our prostate cancer hormone blockade talk. And now, from here on forward, I want to primarily talk about the good that hormone therapy can do, the type of settings that we use it. It's not for every man with prostate cancer. The It needs to be targeted the right amount to the right patient, and so we're going to be talking about how to do that. When we talk about tempered testosterone effect, we're talking about basically three broad categories: the milder ones, the antiandrogens, the LHRH agonists. Most people are familiar with Lupron, and I'll have a slide to explain what Firmagon is. And then the new hormone treatments, the more powerful hormone treatments, say Tig and Xtandi. These medicines, if you look at this, you say, okay, here's the testicles, it produces testosterone, the adrenal gland produces a little bit, and then these testosterone molecules then float into the cancer cell, and they cause all kinds of genetic changes. You can see these medicines all operate at different steps, and therefore, a combination of medicines is potentially more thorough at blocking testosterone than any single agent. Okay? That's the take-home message of this slide, is there may be a place to combine hormone treatments and get better results. So let's talk about, let's go back for a second. So as I mentioned, is there anyone in the room that hasn't heard about Lupron? Raise your hand if you have never heard of Lupron. Okay, go. One, two, three, four. Okay. So this is kind of like Kleenex, you know. The Kleenex is a tissue. Kleenex is a product name. Lupron has become so ubiquitous, we just call these LHRH agonists, we call them Lupron, but there's actually several generics and Noxop, Trelstar, and Elga. What these things do is they fool the testicles into the cessation of making testosterone. So testosterone in the blood normally runs from 3, 4, 5, 600, and it'll go down to less than 20 when you get a shot of this medicine. So it eliminates testosterone from the blood. It works by tricking the hypothalamus. And when you give Lupron and Trelstar, there's an initial, about 2 to 3 week surge of testosterone. It's called a flare. And then that testosterone actually goes up, and then it plummets down to zero. And you can see how that might not be too desirable. If someone had a serious cancer, you don't want to have the testosterone flaring up. And so another company has designed an almost similar medication called Firmagon or Galarex. And in this particular medication, it causes the testosterone to plummet straight to zero. There is no flare. And so this is an attractive medicine. We'll occasionally use it in people for their first shot. The other thing you can do is just add another pill or something on top of one of the older products. But people should be familiar with this, the fact that this product exists. There is some discussion, which I should address. The company that makes this has come up with some studies trying to suggest that it's actually more potent than Lupron. Not only does it have, they claim that it is the absence of flare, but that it has better anti-cancer efficacy. There are some experts in the country that believe this and ascribe to it. I am not one of them. I believe that this medicine is equally effective as Lupron and the other products. And because they don't have any long-acting shots, and because they give shots under the skin and it causes rashes in everybody, I don't use this except to start the treatment. That's my opinion. So this is a controversial area. There are some physicians that believe that all men should always get this product because they think it's a little better than Lupron. I disagree. No one knows who's right. Okay, so we're getting quickly through to the end of this talk. I'm going to go through the different types of prostate cancer quickly and talk about the type of hormone therapy and its role. So when we think of prostate cancer, we divided at the PCR, we divided it in shades of blue. The traditional thing is, you know, the low-risk patients, well, they're the ones we watch. We don't give them any hormone therapy, obviously. Then we have what are called the newly diagnosed intermediate-risk patients. These are the men that have a prostate cancer that is just serious enough to think you're going to need some treatment. In other words, if you don't treat it, there may be a 2 to 4% chance of dying within 10 years. Not a very high chance, but some chance. Therefore, people talk about treatment. That's called intermediate risk. We say the shade of blue is the teal shade. And a lot of studies have been looking at giving radiation by itself, radiation with seed implants, radiation with hormone treatments for a short period of time, hormone treatments for a long period of time. And what this is kind of what all that hard work is boiled down to, and these types of studies have been going on for 20 years, really comes down to if you do radiation, and by the way, I favor radiation treatments much over surgical treatments, I believe the cure rates are better, the side effects are less. That's good enough for me, okay? So if you talk about taking radiation for a patient with intermediate risk, this is like a grade 7, a PSA of maybe 10 to 15, something like that. There are ways to find out if you're intermediate risk. You can go to the PCRI website. It turns out that if you have radiation by itself versus radiation with just 4 months of TIP, only 4 months, okay? 4 months. In this particular case, they gave an anti-androgen flutamide. It's kind of like Casodex with Lupron. The death rate at 10 years in this group was reduced from 8% to 4%. Right? So now you can see why the equations are difficult. You say, okay, so a 4% difference in survival at 10 years, Dr. Scholz, that means it's 1 in 25 patients are glad they took the 4 months of TIP. Because they lived. And 24 out of 25 patients, if I'm doing my stats right, am I doing it right? 4% difference into 100, is that 1 in 25?
Yeah.
Thank you. The 24 out of 25 said, shoot, I didn't have to do that in 4 months of hormone therapy. Now, 4 months is not a very long time, but it takes probably another 2 to 4 months to recover from it. So you're talking about 6 to 8 months of low testosterone. And you'll never know if you were the 1 out of 25. Okay. Yeah, okay, well, might be reasonable to do that. But you can see it's not a, like a no-brainer, is it? It's like, maybe I will just skip that, you know, breasts and hot flashes and loss of libido and penis shrinkage and osteoporosis, and I'll just swing it. I'm going to take a 1 in 25 chance. Okay? So here's another study answering the same type of question. In this case, they gave 6 months of just Lupron alone, radiation with Lupron versus radiation by itself. In this case, they saw a difference in cancer death within 4 years, not in 10 years, within 4 years. So this one wonders if this number is going to get bigger with time. 6% difference. 6 months of treatment of hormones versus none. So if you talk to experts about treatment of prostate cancer for intermediate risk, there's not much debate about giving hormone therapy. It's considered standard. After all, us doctors, we don't have to have the side effects. You do. So might as well, you know, cover our buns from a medical legal point of view. Everyone says, of course, you don't want to die, do you? Well, I mean, there's a chance that if you don't take the hormones according to this study, I don't know what 6 into 100 is. What is that, about 1 in 15 or something like that? There's a 1 in 15 chance that you'll wish that you did it. So people think, well, the side effects are reversible. It's everyone's telling you to do it. And I certainly mentioned to this patient, and I'm not. Now, what if you're 78 years old? You know, and kind of weak and frail. I wouldn't give any hormone therapy to a 78-year-old that's in poor health. I would just probably give them the radiation. So you got to temper this advice based on each patient's circumstances. All right, so that's the intermediate risk crowd. What about if you go to the more serious type of prostate cancer? We call it a shade of blue of azure, high risk. Now these are people who have high Gleason scores, PSAs over 20. They might have proven lymph node involvement, you know, around the prostate. That means it's already spread, or maybe it's spread up in the seminal vesicle. We're talking about real prostate, serious prostate cancer that can kill people, okay? This is where the idea of pulling out all the guns and maximizing the anti-cancer therapy, because people can die from this type, okay? So a couple of good studies to give you an example. In this particular study, they looked at high-risk patients comparing 3 years of, this is like Lupron, 3 years of Lupron and radiation compared to no Lupron and radiation. 3 years of hormone therapy plus radiation versus no hormone therapy, radiation by itself. Mortality rate after 10 years. And the men that got radiation by itself, 30% mortality from prostate cancer, reduced to only 10% in the men that took the hormone therapy for 3 years. Sign me up. That sounds like a fair trade-off to me. Now, 3 years of hormone therapy is no small deal, but you're looking looking at a 1 out of 5 chance, 20% difference in mortality at 10 years. 1 out of 5 chance that you're dying and you wish you'd taken the hormone therapy. That's pretty significant. Now, but this is hormone therapy for 3 years versus nothing. What about hormone therapy for a long period of time compared to a short period of time? Okay, so this study's been done. And that's listed here. So in this case, instead of 3 years, they gave 2 years, and they compared it. And again, these are high-risk patients versus only 4 months of hormone therapy. 2 years versus 4 months. And there was a difference. There was an advantage for longer term. But look, the difference was only 5%, not 20%. Okay? So this raises the question then, and this is our policy in these types of patients. There subsequently was a trial done that compared 18 months versus no treatment. And they showed that you've got just as good a cure rate as 36 or 24 months. So right now, if you want to just max out your hormone therapy these days, if someone has high-risk disease, the thinking is about 18 months. After that, you're not getting any additional benefit. But in our patients, if they're just suffering horribly after a year, I mean, look, even just 4 months of treatment, they got pretty good bang for the buck. Not as good as 2 years, but not bad. So, and no one's tested a year yet. It needs to be tested. Maybe a 12 months of hormone therapy is just as good as 18 months. So these are the sort of analyses that need to be done. So a patient's already been taking it for 12 months, and they're just skating along, they're doing their weight training, they're keeping their weight under control, they've got a good quality of life. Well, studies suggest that they should go out to the full 18 months. But what about the people that come crawling through the front door and they're just saying, I'm just so tired, I don't know if I can make another month of this. Well, we'll stop their treatment early. We'll stop it after a year. And because we suspect that you're going to get a number that's better than this, and it's not going to be that much different than this. So judgment has to be done in terms of how long you're going to continue these treatments. So high risk, longer term hormone therapy makes a difference. Not as big a difference from short-term as you would think, but there is a difference. All right, what about hormones after surgery? Everyone says that you don't give hormones with surgery. If you talk to any type of surgeon, if you have a radical prostatectomy, they're saying, the good thing about surgery is you don't need hormones. And the problem is if you're looking at high-risk patients, the cure rates with surgery alone are terrible. These are a bunch of different studies. You're looking at an average relapse rate of 42% with surgery by itself for high-risk disease. So, well, that isn't an argument for hormone treatment. Show me that hormone treatment makes it better, because there were a lot of studies that looked at giving 3 months of hormones with surgery and did not show a difference in outcome. A number of studies that gave 3 months of hormones with surgery and showed no difference. It didn't work. And that's why the surgeons will tell you, no, you never take hormones with surgery. But there are a couple of studies that have added hormone treatment to surgery, and this is a good example. High-risk disease, in this particular study, they gave 2 years of hormones, not 3 months, 2 years of hormones, and these were 481. After 5 years, the relapse rate was only 7.5%. So look down, if you go back, what was it there's a study of 900 men, 32%. There's a study of 200 men that had surgery for 48% relapse. There's a study of 110 men, 55% relapse rate. 7.5% relapse rate at 5 years by adding 2 years of hormones to surgery. Someone has high-risk disease, seriously consider adding hormone therapy. What about, when you talk about high-risk disease, there's one randomized prospective study. High-risk, we'll all agree that if it's spread into the lymph nodes, and you know when the surgery is done, they take a few lymph nodes out and they can tell, is there any cancer in the lymph nodes? If they find cancer in the lymph nodes, that's high-risk. Doesn't matter what the Gleason score is, doesn't matter what the PSA is, that cancer has been demonstrated to be able to metastasize. It's high-risk, okay? So there was a 100-patient study. It was published in the New England Journal of Medicine many years ago, where they got volunteers, 100 patients, all of them had lymph node cancer after surgery. And they asked them to volunteer, said, look, we want to know if giving hormone treatment is going to improve your survival in this setting. We're going to give it for the rest of your life, because back in those years, they didn't know you could stop it at some point. Half the men were randomized by a coin flip to getting hormone therapy and continuing it the rest of their lives. The other half, they only gave them hormone therapy if the cancer came back and spread to the bones. Okay? What did they find? Within 7 years, the mortality rate in the guys that didn't take the hormone therapy was 40%. In the men that took the hormone therapy immediately, the 7-year mortality was only 15%. Dramatic improvement in survival within 7 years by adding hormone therapy immediately after surgery. So this old mantra that you don't give hormones with surgery needs to be seriously questioned. Okay, a couple more slides, we're getting near the end and we'll do questions. Turns out when you give hormone therapy with radiation, someone actually looked at the question, should you start the hormone therapy the same day as the radiation, right after the radiation, or should you have a lead-in time and do the hormone therapy for a few months and then do the radiation? It turns out that it makes a real difference if you start the hormone therapy a few months in advance and then do the radiation a couple months down the line. The cure rates are better and the long-term cure rates are better. Why is that? Well, there's only speculation, but people know that hormone therapy causes an immune reaction. So when hormone therapy kills cancer cells, the dead cells, the debris from the dead cells has to be cleaned up by the immune system. And so as it's cleaning up that debris, it's learning the antigens and the specific genetic makeup of the cancer cells, and those same immune cells can swim around and attack other cancer cells in other parts of the body. So the immune effect of hormone therapy is preserved. But what if you come in and you radiate the whole gland immediately and kill all the immune cells and all the cancer cells? There's no immune enhancement that occurs with that initial lead-in with hormone therapy. That's the reason it's thought that you need to start the hormone therapy for a couple months before you do radiation. All right, this is, I think, the only slide I'm going to talk about where we can talk about combining hormone treatments. If blocking testosterone partially is a good thing, isn't it better to block it more completely? And this question has raged for years. Can you add an antiandrogen like Casodex to Lupron and get better results? And some of the early studies were done with men with really advanced disease, and there wasn't survival advantage, but it was small. And Casodex was really expensive back then, so they decided, it's just not worth it. And now if you hear people, they say, we don't give Casodex with Lupron. But if you test it at an earlier stage when men are trying to be cured, not advanced metastatic disease, men with high-risk disease, these are men you're trying to cure, this particular study showed that adding Casodex resulted in lower mortality rates. There's not a very high mortality in this particular group, 4% versus 2%, but by adding Casodex, which really doesn't add much of any side effects or cost now because it's generic, the overall outcome was superior. And this, I'm going to revert to this in a little while as we talk about some other things at the end of the talk. I think we have about 2 or 3 more slides to go. So, what about if the PSA starts rising after surgery or radiation? What is the role of hormone therapy in that setting? And the answer is, it has dramatic benefit for keeping the disease in check. Studies show that if a person has a rising PSA after surgery or radiation and goes on hormone treatment, he will go into remission for an average of 11 years. Remission, I didn't say survival. They're going to survive beyond the remission, right? The average remission time is 11 years. Average. Some shorter, some longer. Some people, they never relapse. It's such a good situation that studies have now shown that you don't even have to take the hormone therapy continuously. You can take it for a period of time and then take a holiday. PSA starts to creep up again, then go back again. Intermittent therapy can be used, and it has just as good a results as continuous therapy. So this is obviously, hormone therapy is the safety net and one of the things that takes the teeth out of prostate cancer, even relapse prostate cancer. People that have bad prostate cancer go through surgery or radiation, the cancer comes back, but no other cancer has a safety net like hormone treatment. That's why one of the things that makes prostate cancer so unique. And as we talk about more advanced disease, I'm talking about that last slide is about a rising PSA after surgery or radiation. Their scans are clear. There's no spots in the bones. If when prostate cancer becomes advanced or has metastasis into the bones, we're talking about another order of magnitude. You're not really looking at 11-year remissions. You're looking at average of 2 to 6 year remissions, okay? It's a more serious situation. So one of the things that needs to be, people need to know about is the quality of the response to hormone treatment in these advanced cases is what defines how well people are gonna do. If you take your best treatment and it gives you a poor result, your best treatment and it gives you a poor result, that's not a good sign. That means the cancer is pushing back in a big way. Well, how do you know it's giving you a poor result? The PSA doesn't go all the way down to zero. The PSA is like a speedometer for this disease. We call it the PSA nadir. So the lowest PSA for a successful remission is to get the PSA below at least below 0.1. If the PSA can't get down to less than 0.1, that's a sign of early hormone resistance. We have to talk about the Zytiga and Xtandi for hormone resistance. So how long does it take for the PSA to drop down to undetectable levels or to 0.1? Usually about 4 to 6 months, something like that. So if the PSA isn't getting down to this low level, it's time to do something else. That means that you're not attaining complete control of the cancer. It's time to do something more. This is a separate concept. We need to throw this up here because now that that there's been a big conference about screening with PSA, there are actually doctors that have stopped doing PSA testing. And I am seeing patients in the office who are coming in now with a PSA of a couple hundred that have never had a PSA test done, okay? And they're coming in and they've got scans that show spots. So they've never had any treatment, they didn't go through surgery and radiation, they didn't go through a rising PSA, they just went straight to having cancer spread into their bones. And it turns out that someone recently published a study, this is a question that's been hanging in the air, because there is an effective type of chemotherapy for prostate cancer, and I think this is the only mention we'll have of tonight, called Taxotere. Many of you have heard about it. There's always been a question, if someone comes in with a situation like that, and they go on the hormone treatment, should they take chemotherapy right away, or should they wait and see how the hormones work, and then if the hormones don't work, then take the Taxotere. That sounds better because Taxotere has side effects. It's chemotherapy. So let's postpone the Taxotere for quality of life reasons. Well, it turns out that's a big mistake because I can't remember, it's 800 or 900 volunteers participated in a trial, took over 10 years. Again, based on a coin flip, half of them took Lupron by itself, and the other half took Lupron plus 6 months or 6 cycles of Taxotere. More than a year and a half improvement in survival by adding the Taxotere early. So this idea, when people have the more serious types of prostate cancer, of combining treatments and using them as early as possible, is going to get better survival and better outcomes. So this is, I'm just talking about early chemotherapy only for those patients that have advanced disease that are coming in with high PSA levels to start with. The logical question, which is being tested, in the next slide I think it talks about Zytiga, it's one after that. Zytiga and Xtandi, these are more potent hormone pills that we're going to talk about in a minute. Why wouldn't we use them early too in this setting? And of course, logical people are starting up clinical trials to prove that. But if someone has a bad situation, it is possible to get these more powerful hormone medicines off-label now. So if Taxotere costs a year and a half improvement in survival, it's quite likely that these more potent hormone treatments are also going to improve survival if they're used earlier. Instead of waiting for the cancer to get resistant, use it to try and put out the fire at an early stage. Okay, so this summarizes, I think this is the second to last slide, hopefully. I may have lied to you, but intermediate risk patients, high risk patients, relapse patients, advanced disease patients. Those are the four categories. The teal, azure, indigo, and royal shades. Intermediate risk. Start 2 months before radiation and continue for the 2 months during radiation. That's considered the standard fare for intermediate. High risk. Start 2 months before radiation and continue through the radiation, then for an additional 14 months, 18 months total. That's considered standard for high risk. Relapse disease, an initial course of hormone therapy for 6 to 12 months. No one knows quite what the ideal treatment period is. Then you take a holiday, check the PSA and the testosterone every 3 months, and when the PSA rises back up to some arbitrary level, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, depending on how quickly it's rising, restart the hormone treatment. Intermittent therapy for relapse disease. Advanced disease, there is occasionally intermittent treatment done if people can get their PSA all the way down to zero and keep it there for a while. There is discussion sometimes about taking a holiday, but the general policy is to stay continuously on the hormone treatment. This is advanced disease. You're talking about something that's potentially life-threatening, and you don't want to give it any advantages. So, yeah, here's the slide now about these new hormone treatments. How many in the room have not heard of Zytiga and Xtandi? Anyone, raise your hand if you have not heard of Zytiga and Xtandi. Okay, we've got a few. It turns out that the reason the hormone treatment stops working, it was always assumed in the past that when the hormone treatment stopped working, it was because the cancer cells learned somehow how to grow without testosterone. Makes sense, right? The testosterone in the blood is low, the cancer's growing, it must have learned how to grow without testosterone. Not true. Studies subsequently show that what's going on is the cancer cells have learned how to make their own testosterone internally, inside the cancer cell. They manufacture, they synthesize their own testosterone so they can feed on it internally. The testosterone in the blood is zero. There's no testosterone in the blood. But if you biopsy the tumors, there's testosterone in the tumors. So once that was realized, the smart doctors, the researchers, they said, well, there's some things we can do about that. One thing they did is they synthesized a product that stops the synthetic process of testosterone wherever it is, inside or outside the cancer cell. So it shuts down the internal production. That medicine is called Zytiga. Xtandi is a kind of like a cellophane wrap over the switch where the testosterone turns the androgen receptor on. And even though there's testosterone inside the cancer cell, it can't activate the cancer cell to grow. So both of these products have been tested in advanced metastatic prostate cancer, and they improve survival. For the most part, the side effects aren't too much worse than what it is just with Lupron. So other than the fact that they're expensive as all get out, thankfully insurance will oftentimes cover them, these are real winners, and they become very popular. In fact, since this has come out, Taxotere, which, I have an infusion area in my office, it's mostly sitting vacant now because these are so effective, we don't use nearly as much chemotherapy as we used to. So are there any differences between, and should you use one over the other? And the answer is they're so close, it's hard for me to see any advantages. Zytiga, you have to take a low dose of a cortisone pill. You have to monitor the blood because rarely it causes liver problems. So Xtandi doesn't do those things, so that's perhaps an advantage over Xtandi. Xtandi, on the other hand, has clearly been associated with more tiredness than Zytiga, more fatigue. And there's a very, very rare incidence of seizures. So this particular product is really popular with urologists because they don't like checking blood and monitoring for liver problems. I don't think they'd notice if you were tired. So it's is really going to take off. This, we probably use a little bit more. I don't know if it's because this one's been out on the market longer, and we've gotten used to it. We check blood on everybody, so we don't have any trouble with that sort of thing. But they're both excellent products, and they're real game-changing medications. So people often ask, if the Lupron shots aren't working, and we've got all these new medicines, Zofigo, Taxotere, Xtandi, whatnot, which one do you use first? And I'll tell you, sometimes we use them in combination, but I'm not going to go into that. I think it's a fair question. What if they haven't been taking one of those older, milder Casodex pills? Shouldn't we use that up? I mean, it's cheap, and maybe we can keep the PSA down for a little while. And I think it is indeed cheap. And the responses tend to be brief, and I think you're just giving the cancer more time. I would bypass this. There's another phenomenon called the anti-androgen withdrawal response. How many of you know that if you were already taking this medicine and your PSA is going up and you stop it, sometimes the PSA goes down just by stopping it? How many of you have heard of that called the anti-androgen withdrawal response? So this used to be real popular when we didn't have anything else to give to people. Let's try stopping it, maybe. And you'd get maybe 2 to 3 to 4 months of a PSA decline. Everyone's thrilled, you know. I think I had one guy that actually had a whole year. Stopped his Casodex and it stayed down for a year. But that was so rare. People's lives are at risk, obviously, in a situation like this. So I skip right over this stuff. And we always give the Probenz first. It's an immune treatment. Only takes 6 weeks. It keeps working for the rest of your life. It's been shown to prolong survival. It has very few, if any, side effects. So this is our first step. And then we follow up right after with either Zytiga or Xtandi. With Provenge slows the rate of PSA rise. It doesn't stop it. So many physicians, I don't understand why, they'll give Provenge and they'll wait around, as if the PSA is going to do something. It's not going to. And so our policy is to immediately put our patients on Zytiga or Xtandi right after the Provenge to get the PSA down and hopefully keep it there forever. That's the goal. If this stops working, you have some choices. There's an injectable radiation called Xofigo. There's two types of chemotherapy. This is pretty new, but I will tell you that if given a choice between Taxotere chemo, which has been the mainstay of this type of treatment for years, and Xofigo, we typically will vote more for the Xofigo. It's a simple injection once a month, usually doesn't have any side effects. The only disadvantage of it is that the insurance companies will only pay for it for 6 months. The company, when they did their trials, in my opinion, they screwed up from a business point of view because they gave a 6 month course and they compared to placebo and they showed that people lived longer. Wow, that's fabulous. All the insurance companies said, well, we don't know if 7 months is safe, so we can't pay for more than 6 months, you know. So the company is Bayer is quickly scrambling now to do studies showing, golly gee, we think it is safe, you know, 7, 8, 9, 10 months. So we're going with the Xofigo before chemo is a general rule, and then if that is not keeping things in check, there's all kinds of combinations of this. So this is a general sequence that we think of in someone who's developing hormone resistance. So last slide, I've finally got there. Testosterone replacement and testosterone blockade. So there's a place for hormone therapy, and there's also a place for replacing testosterone. At the beginning of this talk, I tried to point out that this is a balancing act between these various side effects and the possibility of living longer. You've got to be selective and look at the pros and cons clearly. And there's definitely room. When you talk about here's an intermediate risk, he gets 4 months, and here's a high risk, and he gets 18 months. There's room to flex. You can use combinations of medicines. I think I mentioned to you, they showed an advantage, for example, in people that were, it was intermediate or high risk, I can't remember, where they added Casodex, they got a little better survival, so they gave two hormone treatments. Well, what about adding something like Zytiga or Xtandi in patients that have high-risk disease? This is such a logical thing that they're doing clinical trials, but we're not going to have those results for another 3 to 5 years. In the meantime, patients that have high-risk disease need to talk to their doctors about whether they can take Zytiga and Xtandi with their Lupron, and they'll probably have better cure rates. So with that, I think, do you do a Q&A for a while, Russ? Or?
Yeah, we'll take your questions now, but we want your questions. We want you to raise your hand so that I can get you the mic, and then the question will go on our tape for later review. So if anybody has any questions, let's see the hands. Don't all jump at once now.
Thank you. Xtandi, I think I understood what you said about it there. Does it also affect testosterone production elsewhere in the body, like in the testicles?
Xtandi does not block testosterone production in the testicles. Most people that are taking Xtandi are already taking Lupron. So for that reason, there is no testosterone production from the testicles. But if you administer Xtandi to someone like myself who's not taking, I have a normal testosterone level, the testosterone in my bloodstream will go up. Because the body can sense that there's no testosterone activity, and it starts making more to try and compensate. So Xtandi stops the activity of the testosterone, but it does not eliminate the molecule from the body.
Does it block the activity of activity of the testosterone everywhere?
Yes.
Muscle?
Everywhere.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. There was one in the back there.
Just a clarification on one thing you mentioned about when the blood is too thick, you recommend your patients go in and give blood. Well, once you have cancer, I've been told they can't give blood anymore.
That's true. They won't take your blood. It's tainted. But the idea of donating blood or taking a phlebotomy is a routine doctor office procedure. So your physician, I mean, if you were a patient of ours, you wouldn't really be donating the blood because it wouldn't go to another person, but your blood would be removed exactly the same way as if you were donating it. Yeah.
Hey, hello? Can I push your button?
No.
Hello. I have my PSA was at less than 0.01, and I was on hormonal therapy for 2.5 years, and then it started going back up. At this particular time now, it fluctuates between 1.2 and 3. I'm still taking my 90-day Lupron shot on Casodex and on Avodart. My oncologist doesn't seem to be in any hurry or recommend moving to Zytiga or something else right now. He says there's side effects, and he said as long as you're just kind of in this area, hang in there.
So you want me to read his mind for you?
would you agree with that?
Well, I think you know that I don't, right? You heard what I said.
It's hard for one doctor to dispute another doctor. You don't understand that.
Well, it's just the there certainly are different treatment philosophies. I tend, when you have people where you're losing control with your best available drug, which is Lupron, to me that's a serious development, mm-hmm. and it warrants some sort of a reaction, not an observation. That's kind of what I said before. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yeah, just yell and it'll work.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah, I have a couple questions.
Okay, the mic. How's this? Fantastic. All right, you talked about breast enlargement earlier and femara. Should you do that? Can you jump in and start taking those pills at any time after you're stuck?
Yeah, the idea of the femara pill, you can take it prophylactically to prevent, but in my experience, more than half the men that go on hormone treatments don't develop breast enlargement. I hate to, they're already taking a bunch of pills, and one more pill is not exactly that attractive. My experience is that if you watch, patients are very observant, very careful about for any early development of breast tenderness enlargement, if they get on the femara at that point, they can stop it cold before breast develop.
Okay, well, my breasts are very tender, but they're not, where they're growing. So,
Well, it will eliminate the tenderness.
Okay.
Yeah.
Second question I had was regarding estrogen. I noticed you didn't cover that.
Yeah, so estrogen, if we'd given this talk tonight on hormone therapy, before the advent of Zytiga and Xtandi, I would have had a bunch of slides about ketoconazole and estrogen. Ketoconazole and estrogen were our fallback position for patients that became resistant to Lupron and Casodex. Since the advent of Zytiga and Xtandi, I used to write a ketoconazole prescription every week. Prior to Zytiga and Xtandi, and I haven't written a prescription for ketoconazole for 2 years now, 3 years. I mean, it's just the new products are just so clearly superior. There are some patients that don't have any insurance. I find Dr. Myers on the East Coast, he sees a lot of patients that don't have insurance. He uses a lot of ketoconazole, a lot of estrogen. It's very inexpensive. In my judgment, they're not anywhere near as potent as Zytiga and Xtandi, but they do have some efficacy. But since these better products have come out, we really don't use them. Estrogen has another purpose, and that is it's usually our go-to treatment for hot flashes. It's a tiny little patch of Vivelt dot patch will usually eliminate hot flashes just beautifully. So we do use estrogen to eliminate hot flashes, but as an anti-cancer maneuver, it's weak. It's just these patients that are resistant to Lupron have a more serious type of prostate cancer, and we don't like to use ineffective treatments. There was one other thought I had about estrogen. Some doctors have talked about using it to prevent bone loss. So instead of taking Lupron, take estrogen. But estrogen in bigger doses causes breast enlargement in a big way. And so I don't see estrogen as a substitute for Lupron as being a very attractive alternative. Did you have another question? Yes, estrogen does indeed lower testosterone, just like Lupron does. I look at it as a potential competitor to Lupron. Estrogen also, if you give it in a pill form, has an increased risk of blood clots. So we've never really been super excited about estrogen. We used to use it as a fallback position in people are resistant to Lupron. Because we didn't have any other options, but now we've got a lot of options, so we don't use it for that anymore.
Over here first, and then I'll
Thank you for a great presentation. You're one of our favorites.
I'll use the booming one.
Okay. The question is, person that has, let's say, advanced cancer and it's progressing, would it make sense to block T at three different pathways, the testis, the receptor, and inside the cell?
I would say that, oh, sure. Zytiga, you may realize, and Xtandi block the testosterone inside the cancer cell with a different mechanism of action. So Zytiga blocks the synthesis, and Xtandi blocks the testosterone from getting into the nucleus. So what about giving them together? And there are studies doing this. We have a patient, an amazing story, a young man, he was in his early 50s. He was so young, they'd done no PSA testing, presented with a severe bone pain. His PSA was like 800. He went on Lupron and Casodex. His PSA dropped down to about 200 and then started rising. So he had early hormone resistance, looked pretty grim. He went out to MD Anderson and they had a study going. This is almost 3 years ago now. I presented this case at the September conference last year. He went on a combination of Zytiga and Xtandi. They kept him on his Lupron. His PSA dropped to less than one and it's been there to this day. For 3 years, completely saved his life. Now, could he have had that same response with the Zytiga alone or the Xtandi alone? We don't know. But I'll tell you, it's when you see stuff like that, it gets your attention.
Before I give the mic to Arnie here, I want to just give a preface to him. He has severe hot flashes, and he's Dr. Turner's patient, and he would like to know what you can do to help his hot flashes.
Not only do I have hot flashes, but I have a desire to go out and buy women's shoes. I do have hot flashes about every half hour, and I am taking a transdermal estrogen patch. Dr. Turner started off at 0.25, but that hasn't done anything, and I've doubled up on it, and I'm not sure, you know, I'm going to count on him and let him guide me, but with these progesterone injections, is that something that you would do?
Definitely.
If the patches aren't working? Or?
Yes. So estrogen has been our go-to first step. Second step is a progesterone injection, and those can be very effective. Third step is an antidepressant called Effexor or a neuroleptic called Neurontin. Believe it or not, there have been very quality studies showing that acupuncture can reduce hot flashes too. So sometimes in people that are really hurting and they aren't getting a response to estrogen, you might have to do two or three things in combination. It can.
The other question I had was with the either the patches or the progesterone injections, is there some kind of a bone loss related to that?
No, actually estrogen has a protective effect on bone loss.
Does the progesterone actually help with bone loss?
I don't honestly know the answer. There's no evidence that I'm aware of that would suggest that it would make it worse. As we mentioned in the talk, all of our patients that are taking any kind of a hormone medicine, they're all on some sort of protective agent anyway. Prolia, Boniva, Fosamax, something. I can't imagine taking hormone therapy myself and not doing something to protect my bones at the same time. So estrogen may add a little more, but I believe that you should be taking something to help protect your bones, like Fosamax or Prolia or something.
I might mention about Arnie before I take the next question that he had no intention of coming to this talk tonight until I told him that you were going to be here. So.
Thanks for coming.
It works, is that
right? Okay. I think you're a Trojan.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah. Actually, my grandfather graduated from USC Medical School in 1917. My father and mother both went to USC. I attended USC, and my daughter is studying business and accounting, so we have four generations of Trojans.
At least you know my surgeon, this is Dr. Ryskowski.
Yes, I think he retired fairly recently. Is he still? Yeah.
He did.
He's talking about Gary Ryskowski, a very famous prostate surgeon.
Yeah, yeah. He did surgery for me. Mm-hmm. As way back, if I go back, I have some questions, by the way. It started in 2002, and start from there, my ESA start increasing.
After the surgery?
Before. After a year, it increasing for 12, 24, 75. And finally, after at 205, it turned out to be positive. So I learned, even if it's negative, doesn't mean is negative, because it might not touch the prostate cancer, correct? Before, it's negative, and finally...
When you're talking about that, you're talking about your biopsy?
Your biopsy was negative? Is that what you're talking about?
What was negative?
Negative is... not the BSC. The BSC climbing all the way to until 75. But before, the biopsy is negative until 205.
Yes. So I'm glad you mentioned that, because what usually happens is the cancer is hiding in the front of the prostate outside the reach of the needles. And that problem has been thankfully solved in the last 3 or 4 years with the advent of newer, better imaging. So the cancers can't hide like they used to. So that's the beauty of modern technology with these multi-parametric MRIs, color Doppler ultrasounds, is you can see the cancers in the front and biopsy them. So fortunately, we don't encounter that problem anymore.
Yeah, that's why Dr. Ryskowski told me you should have checked before that. I didn't know anything about prostate cancer at that time.
Yep.
Anyway, after that, my first question is, what do you define aggressive? In my case, it's what I see from your PSA, jumping there. And my grade is 3, because my maximum is 4, right? And the Gleason score is 8. Is that
so you're talking about a PSA of 75 and a Gleason score of 8?
8 and the grade is 3.
Okay. And did they do a body scan to see if there's any spots?
No, they didn't do anything at that time. In 2005, they could do the right away with Lupron. Not with Dr. Biscoff.
So what's your PSA now?
Oh. Let me tell you.
Well, we don't have time for your whole story, but where are you at right now?
Right now it's 1.2. But the first shot with Lupron is 22 milligram, I guess. It's down from 75 to 0.6. And Dr. Ryskowski says, now I'm ready to take your prostate out, if you want. He explained to me all the side effects. I said, I don't care about side effects. Just do it, clean it up. I want open, radical. Okay? And he told me, because you, this is aggressive, Joseph, how do we know it's more or it's spread? And after 6 months, from 0.03, with total negative, and then jumping again. Every 3 months.
I think you need a consultation, sir.
Yeah.
we'll give you some cards.
And to make my last, yeah. my last question, of course, is...
Well, one more question, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. My last question is, I asked Avoda, and he agreed, Dr. Minsky, then my PSA, my testosterone, as well as DHEA doses was very low.
So let's talk about Avodart. I think that's a good topic. The I didn't mention Avodart and Proscar. If I'd given this talk 5-10 years ago, I would have probably had 3 or 4 slides on Avodart and Proscar. When the intensity of treatment available has been multiplied like it has with Xtandi and Zytiga, the very mild hormone treatments that we were so grateful that we could squeeze in the last dime out of the hormone therapy milieu has become, in my opinion, somewhat less important, because we're talking about things that move the needle in a big way and things that move the needle in a very small way. So we do use Avodart and Proscar, but with a lot less enthusiasm because it doesn't have the same horsepower compared to some of the newer agents that we have. So, what do you think? One more, maybe, Russ, and we'll call it a night?
Two more.
Who's that?
You're up.
Okay.
You got the mic.
You're in control.
I'm having a problem approaching from the other way. I got involved with concerns about PSAs because I had very low testosterone, apparently naturally or caused by something else. So the doctor gave me shots to boost my testosterone and then had me using some sort of a salve, the name of which I forget. And then all of a sudden my PSA was reading 25. So we dropped that immediately, and my PSA went down to where it's supposed to be, roughly. And now it's starting to trend up again. This is over a period now of a few years.
So you've never had a prostate biopsy?
I had a prostate biopsy a couple of years ago.
And there was no cancer?
They didn't find any cancer.
Okay, so this is the same story as our gentleman here. You need to get an imaging study if you haven't had one.
I think you're right. The conclusion I came out of this.
We have a list of the imaging studies in the packet that you received.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, you got to find out where that was from, and
yes.
There's something going on. Yeah, one more.
Okay, the reason I want to do this last one, Mark, is Mike was diagnosed at age 48 with a multi-hundred PSA and multiple bone mets stage 4. And he deserves to have a question answered.
We can stay for a few more of us. This is your show, not mine. So you tell me when we're done. Go ahead.
Yeah, so as Russ said, I was diagnosed at 48. I was having some hip pain. Long story. But anyway, I ended up in the hospital. They came back. They found a PSA of 175. I'd never been tested. Didn't know anything about it. After I got out of there, they gave me a doctor to follow up with. I went and saw that guy. He basically told me I had 18 months. So I couldn't run out of that office fast enough.
Smart move. You know, doctors that know that think they know the future, you kind of wonder about their judgment. I mean, that's just as a general rule, be real careful. This is not uncommon. I think the helplessness of the situation when a doctor faces someone he doesn't really have answers for, starts spouting out, hey, I read my medical books, I know my statistics. The problem is, statistics are for groups of people. They can't tell the future for an individual. So I'm glad you ran, and anyone else that runs into that type of mentality where someone wants to tell you how much time you got, get out of that place. That's a very unhealthy type of thing, in my opinion. Anyway, go ahead.
So I ended up at the City of Hope right now, and I'm getting treated by Dr. Kowalski.
I think is a great physician.
Yeah. He's a prostate specialist. Yeah.
So, I'm also on Zytiga right now. I'm still on Lupron. We did a thing with Casodex. It lasted about a year, and then my PSA shot up, so they took me off that. Still do the Lupron. They had me on Xgeva. I had a reaction to that. With my mouth, a piece of my mouth fell out because I did some dental work. So here's where my question is. When I got diagnosed, I have cancer in three spots. It's through my hips, it's in my spine, and it's in my rib. So I've talked to them about radiation, and Dr. T doesn't want to go down that road. He pushes it off as much as he could. Now, I know with my hips, he talks about that's where it's building up. That's where everything's coming through, right? That's your, it's building your calcium and all this stuff. And so he's like, he wants, so I said, well, what about my rib and my spine? Especially my spine, because it worries me. But they don't want to go down that road yet. My question would be, if there's just small spots, why wouldn't they want to just, I've also talked to a gal who you probably know down here, Amanda with the CyberKnife. And I spoke with her and have actually sent her my scans.
Amanda Schwer, yeah. Who is a radiation specialist. So I think I can see where your question is going. The question, and you tell me if I've stated it right, but the question is if there's a couple of spots and if the radiation treatment to zap those spots is pretty safe, why would we let the spots live? Why not kill them with the radiation? And and of course your question is, well, why isn't the doctor doing it? Again, I can't read minds, but I can tell you that the idea in the old days, many, many years ago, the quality of scans that we had were really crummy. And if you could see spots in the bones, that usually meant that there were a multitude of other smaller spots lurking around the rest of the body. In other words, you're just seeing the tip of the iceberg. So if you go out and chop the tops off icebergs, you know, the ice just rises up again. Or it's the old thing of like a whack-a-mole. You hit one spot, another spot shows up. So that's people like Dr. T, I can't pronounce his name, and myself, we were trained in an era where it was thought to be useless to try and zap spots. But what's changed is that the scans now are so much more accurate and sensitive that it's possible that if you see a couple, three spots, that maybe those are the only spots. And with modern radiation, you can sterilize them and have a significant impact on controlling the disease. So the thinking these days is people that have less than five spots are potential candidates for zapping the spots. That depends on where they are and a lot of other factors, but the idea is, they have a name for it, it's called oligometastatic disease. That means few spots. It's a controversial and new area. Dr. Schwer is on the cutting edge of that sort of thing, and I would trust her judgment. I've referred patients there myself, so you might want to get a second opinion. It's an art. Right? There's not a right or a wrong here, but I think it's worth pursuing and looking to see if it is feasible. Now, why not just radiate people with 8 spots, 10 spots? After all, if we can kill cancer, it's obviously good. The problem is that the bone marrow, where the spots are lurking, is the same area that produces your immune system. And that tiny area that gets radiated will be sterilized, and the immune system will, in that area, the production will not recover. So as you start expanding to larger and larger areas, you're sacrificing a piece of your immune system. At a certain point, that's not good. So you can get away with a little bit, very specified, but you can't get away with a lot. And that's a judgment call. So I think getting a second opinion from Dr. Schwer may be useful for you.
I also did the Provenge right out of the gate, too.
Good.
So I went through all that. One last question. And I've been trying to get the right answer for this, and I seem to... not get the answer I guess I'm looking for. I'm on this prednisone, it's a steroid, and you talk about the weight gain. I've put on 70 pounds since I got diagnosed. With the pain, my back pain, my hip pain, all the stuff that I went through, going to the gym and doing all this workout stuff is not going to do me any good. It's actually going to put me in bed for several days at a time. So I haven't done any real physical workout type stuff. In fact, I was told to be careful not to break some bones because they may not heal. But I want to go back to the prednisone because it's a steroid, and that's also going to come to help put weight on me. My question question is, why do you have to take prednisone with the Zytiga?
Okay, so we mentioned that Zytiga and prednisone are given together. This is one of the disadvantages of Zytiga, supposedly. The answer is that Zytiga by itself can deplete your body of potassium, and prednisone protects that from happening. If you deplete your body of potassium too much, it's dangerous. So that's why, that's the reason for the prednisone. Some people don't tolerate prednisone very well, and there is another medication on the market called Inspra that is not a cortisone medicine. It's a potassium-sparing diuretic. And so there is an alternative to the prednisone. Alternatively, also, you may find that the 5 milligrams twice a day that you've been taking probably for a long time could be reduced to maybe 5 milligrams once a day.
They just did that.
Yes. So that would be a logical first step, and see if a smaller dose of prednisone will accomplish the same way of protecting your potassium. So you have a couple different ways you can go. I would encourage you to try and start the exercise again. It's not going to, you're absolutely right, it's not going to overnight turn your life into a transformative way, but it is a good way to protect your bones. It helps keep your spirits up, and you will discover that if you're consistent and you don't miss it, you will start to build strength, and that will be useful if, God forbid, you need to take other treatments that have other side effects. The stronger you are, the more resilient you are, the more able you are to go through other treatments as well. So I would try and get back to the gym. I know it's not a very happy prescription, but I think it would be useful if you could do it. Are there any other ones we want to do?
Well, Mark, you opened the door and said that I could take a couple more questions. I have two gentlemen here that have been trying to get in, so.
Sure.
Thanks, Russ. I just had a quick question. You mentioned at one time, if you're considering radiation therapy, to select a skilled radiologist.
Sure.
And my question is, how would you go about selecting that person or judging the facility or the doctor? And how do you even know who's doing the work when you're in a separate room and they're somewhere else?
Well, generally speaking, if you consult a specific physician, he is the one who will be doing it. But the first question, of course, is a challenge of finding a quality anything, a quality plumber, a quality painter. And you know, how do you know that they, just because they say they're good at painting, that they're actually good at it? And the answer usually starts with word of mouth. And the other thing, of course, the inside track, is if you can find another professional painter that really knows painting, and he vouches for that painter and says, oh yeah, that guy's a star. And I think that's one of the big value-added services we provide, is that we've been in the Southern California area for 20 years working with these different people, and we've learned through experience the quality people. I mean, you can look at the people in academia will tend, the quality of their equipment. Places like UCLA, Cedars-Sinai have top physicians.
So
There's different ways to try and answer that question, but I think it's mostly either word of mouth or finding another excellent painter and getting a recommendation about the painter.
Last question.
For the value of time that you spend, how would you compare an elliptical or a treadmill compared to weight training?
Well, that's a good point, because I think ellipticals and treadmills, first of all, to get the same value that you would with weight training, you'd have to probably do it three times as long, okay? And then, when you're all said and done, I think you'll get about half the benefit.
From a treadmill,
treadmill or
weight training, really, because you're hitting all the different muscle groups.
Correct. I'm glad you asked this question. It's very dear to my heart, because the loss of muscle, which occurs with low testosterone, can be dramatic. Men can lose 30, 40, 50% of their muscle. And you think, well, it's not a cosmetic thing. It's actually, that's you. There's no more, you is gone. And I tell you, the fatigue and the depression that come from that is dramatic. And the weight training is a hard prescription to try and compensate. I realize that, but no one has come up with anything close. And the commitment to get into the gym and do 3 sets of 10 reps on every major muscle group 2 or 3 times a week is transformative in patients that are taking hormone treatment. So I hardly endorse people. Usually people need to get a trainer to get that consistency. And last word on the whole idea of training is that
testosterone helps you build muscle. Can I borrow your...
Testosterone helps you build muscle, obviously, but it helps sustain muscle. Women can build up muscles, but as soon as they stop training, they disappear within a couple weeks. If I train and I stop for a couple weeks and come back, I can feel it, but I've still got muscles left there. So you guys that are doing training with low testosterone levels, there's no time for a holiday, period. You have to be consistent. You can't take a holiday. And I'm sorry if I had any shortcuts. I gave you a bunch of pills, but I didn't have a pill for maintaining muscle mass. So, great way to end this. You had one last comment, sir? The question is, am I a supporter of a total gym? What is a total gym?
The total gym, the one where you can change the use of your legs and your arms and all that.
Sure. Any kind of resistance training, the idea is to take the muscles to failure. So that's why I say 3 sets of 10 reps. So if I do curls for my biceps, and I do 10 times, and then I rest for a minute or two, do 10 more, rest for a minute or two, do 10 more. The idea is that toward that 10th one and the third one that is starting to be, I'm having trouble complete. That's taking the muscles to failure. And if you do that on all your major muscles twice a week, maybe preferably 3 times a week, you can actually end up the year stronger. I've had a number of engineers that have graphed this out. They've gone on programs. They start their loop on January 1st, for example, go on their weight training program, and they have more muscle at the end of the year, and they're stronger than when they started. Now, that's quite a contrast from someone that loses 40% of his muscle but not doing any exercise. Wow, what a difference. So thanks for that question. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, Mark and
I have to share.
Just a quick comment. You got to believe a guy that gets up between 4 and 5 in the morning because he's so busy with his practice to go to the gym and hires a trainer to work him out, and he doesn't even have prostate cancer, and he does it. I can't afford to pay him. Actually, I do pay him. But this is probably his third cup that he's gotten from us, so maybe you'll have a whole collection. Thank you very much, Dr. Scholz. Give me a favor, folks. Oh, give me a standing ovation. That's the first time I've ever had that here. Give me a favor, folks. We know we have this.